Good morning, everybody. Welcome. We're delighted to have you here, and thank you for coming out on an early morning. And this is going to be really an interesting discussion. I'm a little blurry. I got back late last night. I recently was in Burma, and or now Myanmar, and you know, it's a tortured country. It did it to itself, unfortunately. It was there had been a military coup 50 years ago, and they systematically just kind of undermined what had been one of the most promising economies in Asia, and destroyed a bureaucracy, and kind of undermined what was a good rule of law system. But they're now coming out of it. And our ambassador there is doing a fabulous job, and the team is doing a fabulous job, but they are starting from really scratch. And we want them to succeed, and we want them to become a partner. And they need help. And that was the backdrop for me when I read this report over the weekend. I hadn't really appreciated that we were doing this work, and it was something that was seized upon by Congressman Boustany and by Congressman Polis and said, this is important to us. Trade is an important dimension of America's engagement, not just its economy, but its foreign policies is important to us. But we need to look at how well do we do this? How well do we help other countries like Burma become successful? And how can they reach up? And it's one of those things, we're not well organized. We've got good tools in the government, but we're not well organized as a government. And I think that what you're going to hear today, it's rare, let me say, when two members of Congress, especially across the aisle, were prepared to sit and work on the kind of the deep plumbing of government and say, how do we make this better? And it's a tribute to them that they were willing to take this time. And I want to say a personal thank you. It's a rare thing and a much appreciated thing when we see this level of leadership in government. And I'd say thank you to you for it. I thank my friends from Chevron who have been making possible this series on development. It's a very important thing for us to be able to present to the Washington policy community, and they've been generous in their support to make it happen. And I would just like to give a shout out to two of our young colleagues, and that's Charles Rice and Christina Perkins, who did so much of the work in making this happen. I'll just tell you, people like me get to stand up here and take a lot of credit for good things that happen, but those are the guys that do the work. And so I should be honest about it and say a sincere thank you to them for really fine, fine work. Let me turn it over to you, Dan. I think we want to get this started for real. And again, let me just say, Congressman, thank you for being here. We're really honored that you're here.
Thank you, Dr. Hamry. I also want to thank our friends at Chevron. Thank you, Joanna, for being here. We were able to do this through our Chevron partnership. They grasped this immediately, the role of the private sector in development. We've been working with them for a number of years. And want to also thank Caitlin Sinolfi, who is Dr. Boustany's point person on trade-related issues. If it wasn't for her, in terms of her tireless efforts to help us, I think this also would not have gotten done. So, Caitlin, thank you very, very much. You're going to hear from some of the members of the expert panel, the task force that we put together, there really was a great, great group, and in particular, Andrea and Delma and Paul in particular, you're going to hear from them. It's just really great. And then I think we could not have done this without Scott Miller, who really knows the trade world very, very well. We had to have both trade and development together in one conversation, which is an interesting cultures that as well. So I think it's very, very interesting. As Dr. Hamry mentioned, this came about because Dr. Boustany spent his long Thanksgiving holiday, his 4-day holiday, reading a report that Scott and I had written about a new development agenda about trade, investment, and procurement, and called Scott and said, can we come talk about this? And I said, I don't think I spend my Thanksgiving holiday reading our report, so I was quite impressed that, I do read them, but I don't spend my Thanksgiving holiday doing so, but I thought that was great. And then he talked about his vision for how do we get all of American power together? How do we use American power in a thoughtful, coordinated, strategic way? That was where he was coming from. And then Obviously, we were very, very grateful to get Congressman Polis. Thank you as well. Well, look, I think you have the report in front of you. I'm not going to say anything more, but the members of Congress are very busy. So I'm going to turn the floor over first to Dr. Boustany, Congressman from Louisiana, and then we'll hear from Congressman Polis. Dr. Boustany, thank you.
Well, Dan, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Dan, I want to thank you and Scott. This was a great, great effort and a lot of fun doing this. And I want to thank the entire team at CSIS for turning this idea that we brainstormed in my office one morning into reality. And I think we've got a really good report. To my friend, Jared Polis, thank you. I really appreciate it. This was a bipartisan effort. And this is where our best work comes from, when we can put our heads together and really, you know, come up with a solid proposal that both sides can agree to. I think this is the basis of really good policy. And I want to thank all the members of the task force who braved some early mornings on Capitol Hill. A lot of heated discussion, and I think it really led to, you know, really fleshing out a lot of the details that we've been able to work on. But as many of you know, the United States has been involved in trade capacity assistance for quite some time, working with developing countries to help them benefit from global trade. And at the same time, we have seen trade, world trade, undergo dramatic expansion and changes over time over the last 20 years. Growth rates for international commerce have clearly surpassed both population and production. And most remarkably, the share of world trade from developing countries has now surpassed that of industrial countries, mirroring the parallel rise in income and purchasing power in the developing world. And even so, not all countries have participated equally in these advances. Many poor countries still strive to fully benefit from integration into the global markets. And so now, as we've embarked on two 21st century agreements, TPP and TTIP, I think it's really important that we understand the role of trade capacity building, because clearly this is going to make a difference as we take these very disparate economies and try to pull them together in a 21st century agreement that involves not just tariff reductions, but dealing with the complexity of regulatory coherence, many of these 21st century issues. And I just got back from Asia, visiting some of our TPP countries, and in particularly as we sat down with the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Foreign Minister, and others there, it becomes quite evident that we have a lot of work ahead of us to try to pull this together to make this type of an agreement successful. But I do believe that these kinds of agreements will really benefit from a robust trade capacity building piece. And I think we can clearly set new standards for trade if we look at it in this way. I believe that, I mean, you think about this, you got Vietnam and Malaysia trying to work out a 21st century trade agreement with the United States and Canada and Australia and the others in this agreement. We've got to figure out, how do you bring this all together? These countries want to be a part of this, but they're going to need the assistance. And this is where we have a huge opportunity. I believe it's through trade capacity building that the United States can actually maximize the benefit provided by trade liberalization across the board. It'll certainly ensure that our partner countries can meet the requirements of the agreements, and also guarantees that developing nations can capitalize on a new and beneficial trade agreement that will see their population benefit. I do believe that trade capacity building is more necessary than ever. As I mentioned earlier, trade has become a very complicated issue with many new problems that have arisen as we've entered this 21st century. So, but as we talked about on that very first day in my office, trade capacity building has not received the kind of attention it really needs to have. And so the task force meetings, During all this effort in the task force meetings, it became apparent that deficiencies were clearly present in the quality of products, speed of transport, quality of regulation that prevented many of these countries from reaping the full benefits of trade agreements. We need to update our trade capacity building strategy to reflect the current environment. And I think there are clearly a number of lessons to be learned. Many of these we fleshed out as we discussed the problems. And it's reflected in the report. I do believe that a global system of free trade that engages and allows all to benefit, especially developing countries, should be viewed in the context of the broader national interest of the United States. This is a key piece to our foreign policy, and it hasn't been seen as such in recent years. And it's time to redouble our efforts to make it so. Economic development policy and trade capacity building are now increasingly interlinked as the global market has grown, nations have become more economically connected, and we've got complex issues that we're facing. And so I look forward to really promoting this report, taking what's in the report, and trying to get policies in place that will really move the ball forward on this. So again, thank you for being here this morning, and we look forward to further conversation. And Dan, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you.
Thanks again. Thank you very much, Congressman. Congressman Polis, come on up here and share your perspective on this. It was really great to have you help us co-lead this and co-convene this.
Thank you.
Congressman Polis, will you please come out and oppose trade promotion authority?
Please sit down. Hey, hey.
Authority, as you know, more
okay.
Your
okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I'll be happy to.
Thank you.
I'll be happy to.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I have many outspoken constituents as well who have been sitting in my office and conveying similar messages. Good morning. It's great to see so many people interested at 7:30 in the morning in trade capacity building. Exciting topic
here
today.
Lots of energy, lots of enthusiasm.
Lots of energy, lots of excitement. In fact, I think if you recall, when we first met, my advice was, how do we make this sexy? We've got to make this issue
That's
sexy.
That's right.
Well, having a nice...
We placed him on purpose to kind of wake people up. There you go.
That's right. Having a nice full-color bound report is a step in that direction.
Right.
And Dr. Boustany and I will help ensure that all of our colleagues read every word of that.
Absolutely. There'll be a quiz.
We're going to help circulate that. But again, I want to thank everybody for being here. I want to thank, of course, the Center for International and Strategic Studies for hosting this, Representative Boustany for his great leadership, the CSIS program experts and members of the task force. Trade capacity building is really a critical tool in enabling the growth and self-sufficiency of developing companies. It helps fulfill the promise of trade and helps ensure the stability of our global economy and our global political structure. By growing the ability of under-resourced countries to utilize global trading system and rules for their advantage and for their economic growth, we increase the capacity of our economy here at home as well and the stability of the world as a whole. We enlarge the field of potential customers for domestically produced goods. We encourage innovation and entrepreneurship across the world, and we help promote positive developments in civil rights and the social order in developing nations. By closing the loop on trade among and between greater numbers of countries, we bring the geopolitics of trade and the health of our shared economy further out into the open and enhance the prospects for global economic growth and stability. With the finalization of the Trans-Pacific Partnership proposal on the horizon and the acknowledgement of success and failure among various trade agreements in the past, we're constantly reminded that the enduring global benefit of any major trade agreement depends on its implementation and how heavily the ability of partnering countries have to fulfill their own goals in a trade agreement. Absent this meaningful follow-through and trade capacity building, trade agreements are simply words on paper that aren't given life. With TPP, this includes the responsibility of other countries to meet certain civil rights standards, comply with environmental protections, observe rights for workers, and many other benchmarks. That frankly become harder and harder when a country cannot implement and enforce policies that comply with our perspective of 21st century ethics and norms consistent with trade capacity building under the rules not only stipulated in our trade agreements but also in our laws here in the United States. A developing nation risks losing its ability to fulfill the goals of trade agreements if its economy becomes unable to sustain market competitiveness or expected changes under these provisions. Unfortunately, there's many countries that have legacy capital ownership systems of oligarchies or a few families that own the means of productions without allowing any type of competition. And of course, those types of companies are unable to compete in an increasing global economy. The report under discussion today brings to light not only the need for strength in trade assistance, but the opportunities that exist for increased aid where holes remain for critical trade capacity more broadly. Some of the action items, which I hope are followed up on, are very important to me and my colleagues in Washington, including the commissioning of a task force by the President, a budget item specifically committed to trade capacity building, and a commitment of our foreign ambassadors as well as training to raise the conversation here and abroad. I think these findings are innovative, necessary, and comprehensive, and they'll certainly have my advocacy going forward. I want to thank my counterparts again for this effort. I look forward to working with all of you to building a global trading system that lifts all boats and that every country can universally benefit and that people across the world will be able to derive benefit from as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Congressman. I had a couple questions for each of you. I know you all have you're busy back up on the Hill, and thanks for coming down to be with us. Dr. Boustany, you began this inquiry when you were chairman of the House Ways and Means chairman of the House Ways and Means Subcommittee on Oversight. Could you talk a little bit about how Congress can improve the performance of U.S. trade assistance efforts? Just talk a little bit more about how you think about Congress's role in this.
Well, Congress needs guidance, and I think this report provides a good template for that kind of guidance. And just as we went through our trade capacity programs throughout the U.S. government, we realized it's all spread through different agencies. Congress also has the same type of stovepiping. And I think we have to figure out how in Congress we're going to organize an effort to streamline this type of policy. I think the line item issue in appropriations could be very helpful in providing some guidance there. But as you can imagine, this cuts across USTR, it cuts state, USAID, Ex-Im Bank, OPIC, and other agencies. So this is a perennial problem that Congress has to address as well as our executive branch offices.
Great, thank you. Congressman Polis, in some of your remarks you alluded to this, but many members of Congress are concerned about trade agreements and what the trade assistance programs. How do you hope that they'll improve the results achieved in trade agreements to get folks to have a higher degree of acceptance of trade agreements?
Well, you know, I don't know if trade assistance and trade capacity building are going to change anybody's mind about trade in general, but I hope it's something that both opponents and proponents of various treaties should be able to agree upon. That if we're going to have a particular trade agreement, whether someone supports it or not, to make it work better for the people of our country and certainly the people of the country that we have the trade agreement with, we should invest in and take seriously trade capacity building and trade assistance. So I hope it's a piece that people can agree on. It's also a face to trade that we can talk about more in terms of talking about the benefits of trade and helping countries gain, make sure that those benefits of trade are recognized.
Do you think?
Can I add something to that? Jared and I had some conversations about how can we get small and mid-sized firms involved in trade. Mm-hmm. There's a great deal of interest in my district in this issue, and by building out trade capacity, this helps our small businesses because there's a little bit more certainty in what they're dealing with as they try to engage in commerce overseas. And Jared brought that perspective to the table on this, and it's something I'd been thinking about. And I'd been thinking about it in terms of the agreements, but in terms of capacity building, it's critical.
Yeah, and to follow up, I mean, certainly one of the challenges on my side of the aisle with trade is there's a perception, really misperception, that somehow, oh, it only benefits a few large corporations, right? And frankly, there's large companies that can make whatever rules exist work for them. But who does this type of agreement with the right capacity building really benefit? It's the small and medium-sized businesses. It's entrepreneurs. It's people who are self-employed that are able to participate. So that's kind of putting a better face on trade.
Smallholder farmers, companies. I think of the kinds of programs we talked about in the report, the sorts of programs AID runs, where it's how to help smallholder farmers take advantage of agreements, increase their productivity so they can sell more goods and services into the global economy. So it's just in line with what you're saying, Congressman. Absolutely. I'm just cognizant of the time. Are we okay on time? Because when a trade agreement comes up to the Hill for a vote, how does this play in it? How does this factor in terms of how members of Congress talk about a trade agreement. We touched on this a little bit, but if you could just, it may not necessarily sell the agreement, but does it make it more palatable for some members of Congress to say, well, okay, if this is included in here, I feel somewhat better that either A, it's gonna make trade more accessible for small and medium-sized enterprise, or B, it's gonna help with certain sorts of labor, dealing with certain sorts of labor components or certain sorts of helping them meet certain environmental standards or that sort of a thing. Does it make it more subtle? I certainly think USTR, when they're negotiating these things, see this, and I think we'll hear from the panel, it's sort of something that they trade or they offer it as sort of a, I think I'm gonna put words in their mouth, but when I was at eight, it always seemed to me from the USTR perspective that this was sort of a gimme, or this was sort of something that was sort of as part of getting the deal done.
Yeah.
Is this how people on the Hill see it?
Well, it really should be something that's frankly taken seriously. I plan on talking about it on the floor of the House during the debate. I plan on encouraging my colleagues that are looking at this issue to really take a serious look at capacity building as well. So, I mean, again, it's and also to take the recommendations of the report seriously. So, I mean, it's not just something that people should give lip service to. There's some actionable items. Some of them are congressional. Some of them are executive. And I certainly plan on working with Dr. Boustany and others to follow up on those.
This is music to our ears. That's really great. Thank you.
You know, I think we have a historically open market here in the United States, and I think a lot of our colleagues are concerned about whether we're really truly opening markets overseas for our businesses. Is it a balanced playing field? And I think that's one of the fundamental arguments you hear. And for those who reflexively oppose these trade agreements, I think, you know, they're saying, well, wait a minute, this is really not going to open up the market, because even though there may be some nominal tariff reductions, it's the behind the border issues that are going to still present themselves as barriers to trade and barriers to American business. And so trade capacity building and this type of assistance, I think, while it doesn't solve everything, it helps. It's an additional tool so that we do have a level playing field. And I think it's a tool that we can use to help sell these trade agreements to those who are skeptical.
Could I just ask, I wanted to see if one of the members of the task force or Scott Miller had a question for the members, given this conversation. You all are not shy. No, none of the three of you are shy, nor is my friend Scott Miller. Go ahead, Thelma. Is that on the agenda?
Yes.
So prospective TPA and the currency issue, the question by Thelma Askey, former head of USTDA.
Both very important, timely questions. We are very close to getting finalization of Trade Promotion Authority legislative language, which would then be introduced to the House and Senate, and then hopefully we'll move it this spring as quickly as possible. Because we realize we're on a pretty tight timeline right now. If you're looking at negotiations, looking at the political calendar here and so forth, we really want to move forward with this. And so there are just a couple of minor sticking points, mostly involving Senate-related issues in TPA, and I think we're very close to getting those resolved. So I would look to see Trade Promotion Authority legislation introduced sometime, you know, this spring. And we'll move it. On the currency issue, certainly among Republicans in the House Ways and Means Committee, we are really concerned and do not think currency language should be part of this. These are fights that have occurred before. There are a number of reasons why currency, first of all, there's no agreed upon definition of currency manipulation. We think this is best addressed through the G20 and IMF mechanisms. You can argue whether the IMF mechanism needs to be strengthened through Article 4, and that's something we can talk about. But I think the fact of the matter is, if you do put currency legislation in there, then I think we're opening the door to a number of adverse consequences for the United States. We are the reserve currency. That puts that potentially at risk. We invite retaliation. If you link it to tariffs, then we're basically setting up a potential endless cycle of, you know, trade obstruction. And I think if you're going to address currency manipulation, it's basically a meaningless issue in the bilateral context, you know, with some of the metrics that are used. It's got to be looked at in a broad context to get to a real meaningful definition. And then there are blurred areas between what constitutes currency manipulation versus misalignment, and how do you deal with all that? So we think this is best dealt with outside of TPA, and specifically not, should not be in TPP or TTIP.
Well, Congressman, thank you both for being here. Mm-hmm. You are very busy. We really appreciate y'all coming over here to CSIS. Thank you for your leadership on this task force. We couldn't have done it without both of you. Thank you so much. Please join me in thanking members Boustany and Polis.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you. I'll be in touch. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Scene change. Add a seat.
Is the music going to stop?
Somebody is going to find a chair.
We're waiting for a chair. Why don't I turn it over to
Scott?
Well,
that'd be great.
Scott was we co-directed this together.
I'm Scott Miller. I'm the Scholl Chair in International Business here at CSIS. Had the privilege of working with Dan Rundy and his group and on this particular project. One of the best things that I've discovered about working at CSIS is the fact that you can undertake a project and there are lots of really talented, experienced people out there who are prepared to work with you. It's just it's an exciting and satisfying part of the job here. And this project was one that attracted a uniquely capable group that we call the Congressional Task Force, of people with broad experience through all kinds of government service and private sector experience to help inform this project. And this report would not have been possible without them. We greatly appreciate their efforts. And we're fortunate today to be joined by three of those task force members. Who may be familiar to you, but certainly we greatly value their contribution and hope to have a discussion about sort of the nuts and bolts of trade assistance and how it can work better. Here with me are first Thelma Askey. Thelma is the president of Rockart Global Strategies and also a senior advisor to CSIS, but had a long career in government before this current role, including Deputy Secretary General of the OECD. Thelma was the director of the U.S. Trade and Development Agency and the staff director for the Trade Subcommittee of the House Ways and Means Committee. So it brings broad experience, and particularly we'll get a Senate perspective as well, but we're always glad to, when we have House members, to have somebody from the House to represent. In any case, next we'll hear from Andrea Durkin. Andrea is principal of Sparkplug Strategic Consulting. But Andrea was part of our group because of her crucial experience as a USTR negotiator. Andrea was one of the people at USTR when the U.S. government first decided to do something called trade capacity building and include it in negotiations. And Andrea was one of the people sort of present at the creation to try to figure out how this thing worked and how to make it effective. And her experience was pivotal to this. After USTR, Andrea worked as a director of international government relations for Abbott Laboratories, but is now on her own and running her consulting business. So thank you, Andrea. And finally, Paul Delaney. Paul is principal of the Kyle House Group, a consulting firm, but Paul has the unique experience of private sector, executive branch, and legislative branch experience on issues like trade and development and trade policy. Paul's career includes being trade counsel of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Senate Finance Committee, the Deputy Chief of Staff with the U.S. Trade Representative's Office, and in the private sector, Paul worked for FedEx Express, what we think of as a global company. So in any case, thank you all for your contributions. We welcome you as panelists. And I'd like to start by hearing from each of you in turn about your views on this project and how we move forward. Thelma.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please.
Good morning, everyone. I think it's not so early now, so welcome to those who have joined us. I'll talk a little bit about the importance of trade agreements and it's a historical discussion when we get into the context of trade promotion authority, what used to be called fast track, and also trade agreements themselves, as well as how we can leverage trade capacity building in those agreements and why we might be interested in doing that, in addition to having good talking points for your colleagues when you're trying to get these things through the legislative process. I have to say I'm a bit envious when Dr. Boustany talked about having the fast track, I mean the Trade Promotion Authority bill come up in the spring here within the next few weeks because there was always the hope that you could do these things outside of a political cycle. Or at a convenient time when there's not so much pressure on members to make this decision more objectively. I don't think that ever happened when I was on the Hill. So it did help you say, well, it can be done even in a political season. But it's nice to, I think, to have a little bit of time to reflect on why these agreements are important. And of course, the first reason is how beneficial exporting and world trade is to our country. During the last 5 years, exports have hit record highs. It's now about $2.35 trillion in, at the end of 2013 into 2014, up roughly 50% since 2009. And of course, rising exports contribute to nearly one third of the overall economic growth since the recession in 2008. Over 300,000 American companies export goods. And as the members alluded to earlier, over 95% of those companies are small or medium-sized companies who really need to have a level playing field or a more economic-oriented playing field to deal with. Exports of goods and services supported 11.3 million jobs in the United States, and that's up 1.6 million jobs since 2009. And of course, the jobs issue is always one that we need to discuss in the context of approving agreements, trade agreements, and trade promotion authority. Mm-hmm. It's unfortunate that we don't often get the support, or I don't think ever have gotten the support of organized labor on these issues, but it does help members talk to their constituents about why jobs are important in this context, and the fact that the creation of jobs is not a forgotten or kind of a peripheral issue with respect to these trade agreements. Because jobs that are associated with exports generally pay higher wages, 18 to 20% more than the average wage in the US. I think what we need to do, keep in mind when we're looking at trade agreements and we're looking at trade capacity building as part of those agreements or in the aftermath of those agreements, is that what do we achieve in the broader sense, in a larger policy objective? And of course, we have our own self-interest, and I think the statistics that I have just outlined demonstrates that self-interest. International trade is a large part of our economy, and it also brings these countries into the global trading environment that helps them discipline themselves. It also is a way for the U.S. to exercise leadership. Trade agreements aren't always huge multilateral agreements that take years to negotiate and sometimes years and years and years to negotiate. But when you try to, when the U.S. exercises leadership and does things like TPP and TTIP and others where you're basically looking at, you're looking at the coalition of the willing, even agreements like NAFTA, which started as a U.S.-Canadian agreement and then moved forward, it basically is negotiating, taking the leadership to negotiate with a multilateral brain, but a bilateral or trilateral or small group practical implication, because if you're thinking with the multilateral brain, those agreements can be translated into the larger context at a later time. As countries see that it is worth it to undertake these disciplines and receive these benefits. And of course, trade agreements are a way to discipline ourselves as well as discipline our trading partners, because as you come to these common agreements as to what is expected and what kind of environment you want to trade in, it works to move everyone to the same plane. I think we saw that over and over again with these trade agreements. NAFTA is certainly a good example. Almost immediately after the ink was dry, the peso crisis hit Mexico. But they will certainly say now that the fact that the agreement was in place allowed them to make choices that were probably better for them in the long run, right, than they would have if they didn't have a mechanism to create this self-discipline. And of course, finally, less tangibly, is American economic influence and the projection of American values, because as we undertake this leadership role and try to push for things that the U.S. wants to see, we often achieve very positive results as we show countries why our firms are as creative and as productive as they are, why they have the technology they do. And I think this is a good segue into trade capacity building, because when it comes to trade agreements and the connection with trade capacity building, what these countries often want from the U.S. is that kind of business experience, that kind of technology transfer, that kind of way that the U.S. and these very successful companies do business. We're talking about trade capacity building, not in a sense of providing large agricultural assistance or food assistance, basic needs assistance. This is trade capacity building that allows the U.S. to expand its influence in the way that we do business, highly competitive, highly individualistic, and yet playing by the same rules and disciplines. So we have those things to achieve, and I think when we find out what the countries want in the context of trade capacity building, you will find that high on their list is how does the U.S. make their firms so successful, and can we follow those mechanisms, those best practices, in order to make ourselves as competitive without a lot of government interference or without a lot of government subsidization in choosing winners and losers. So I think we talked briefly this morning about whether or not trade capacity building can help you achieve trade agreements. How much of a bargaining chip are they? It's been my experience that it's not a large bargaining chip, because countries don't want to, kind of get into the morass of trade capacity building before they know what the balance of concessions are going to be on the trade agreement. And so I can think of USTRs who had to continually put this on the table, you know, say, okay, you develop your list of what you want to see when the agreement is concluded. You take the lead on trade capacity building, and we'll try to respond to that. Do we want to work on anti-corruption? Do we just need to work on GSP and how to take advantage of it, or et cetera? So there's a little bit of a dance that goes on with trade capacity building until the balance of concessions reveals itself more toward the end. But I think trade capacity building could be very, very valuable for the U.S. in the context of a trade agreement, because countries can see that when they join a trade agreement, when they accept disciplines under the trade agreement, that the U.S. response is there, and they can see a real value in following the U.S. lead.
Thank you. Andrea, tell us what it was like when you got the assignment to do trade capacity building.
Okay, I'll come back around to that one. Okay. That's a longer story. I always mark half the time by how old my oldest daughter is, because as Bennett will remember, I see him in the audience, I was pregnant throughout the process. That was 11 years ago. So I really appreciate CSIS bringing this topic to the fore again, because it's time to update our thinking about it, and to, you know, there's so many more opportunities today to implement trade capacity building, and we were making it up as we went along, so we'll come back. I think we did a pretty good job, but we made it up as we went along. Listen, I want to address some of the very pragmatic recommendations that are in this report from the perspective of the executive branch, a former trade negotiator, and how we can organize ourselves in a way that the executive branch, working with Congress, can not only execute trade capacity building better, but plan forward and become more strategic about it, more visionary about how we lay the foundation for economic success in developing countries. Dr. Hamry mentioned Myanmar this morning. It's a great point. You know, we shouldn't limit ourselves and our thinking about trade capacity building just to FTA partners. We need to be thinking about laying the economic foundations in markets that are today thought of as frontier markets by U.S. businesses, or with the right investments in trade capacity building can be the frontier markets of tomorrow. The reason I loved the trade negotiating world was because, you know, being a trade negotiator involves a lot of creativity. The pace of business is moving so quickly. The complexity of trade has grown tremendously. It's multi-directional. We have global value chains. And provisions need to be evergreen, evolved, and really invented in order to address the way commerce is conducted today. And the way we think about it is to expand the realm of opportunities. It's not about dividing a fixed pie. And I think we need to bring that kind of mindset to trade capacity building as well. What we try to do as negotiators is to learn from the private sector about how the marketplace works. But I think in doing trade capacity building, we have a whole lot to learn from the development community as well. How do we help companies in developing countries become part of the global value chains? How do we help developing countries become reliable trading partners? How do we help them improve the capacity of their local institutions to support modern economic activity? Well, I think the report rightly points out that there are at least three obstacles to doing that better going forward. The first is that trade policy tends to be centralized, and the execution of development assistance is decentralized. So we have to create more fluid interaction, I think, with the amazing and informed staff we have at the embassies, who know what's happening on the ground, who have local relationships. We also have a tremendous amount of variety of good programming across the agencies. AID is, and the Millennium Challenge Corporation are primary agencies that deliver development assistance, but we have some really great programs across the agencies. When I was with Abbott, as Scott mentioned, I worked a lot with Abbott Nutrition on food safety issues, and particularly in APAC, where we were developing food safety quality training for countries throughout APAC. And USDA and Commerce were pivotal in putting those programs together, and it made sense because USDA has that particular expertise. And so we need to figure out how we improve coordination across agencies to really maximize the value from the programs that reside across various agencies. And I think if we're going to better align trade commitments with trade capacity building, we have to overcome the tendency to segment the negotiations, segment the process of developing trade policy. And I'll explain what I mean about that in just a moment. So how do we leverage the diverse knowledge and skills across the US agencies so that we can see around the corner and develop smart, strategic trade capacity building approaches on an ongoing and not an episodic basis? I think the first thing is, as the report recommends, that we create a formal process so that there is clear responsibility, that there is clear ownership given to an agency or agencies that have a broad view on this, and that they can create a standing committee so that we can better manage on an ongoing basis the planning, execution, and evaluation of trade capacity building. But I do think in order to do this well, we're going to need more staff, and staff are going to have to be dedicated to the process. I don't think you can append this to people who have already really full portfolios and do this right. So I think we have to give trade capacity building its due, dedicate the right amount of staff, have them participate in formal standing processes to do it. And I think given the amount of money we put in trade capacity building, that would be the right and responsible thing to do. Secondly, I mentioned the problem of centralized policymaking and decentralized assistance. A necessary improvement is to ensure that the embassy personnel are also part of that formal organization. You know, they do work together, I know, to develop country plans per the AID process. But let's make sure that that information, that thinking, all of those insights come back to Washington and get fed back into, you know, this new standing committee so that they can benefit from those insights and not be handed an agenda, not have to implement something after the fact that was cooked up in Washington. They should be part of the planning process, part of the execution process, part of the evaluation process. And it works in both directions. Certainly those country plans could be well informed by the discussions that go on in the standing committee that's based here in Washington. So it works both directions. I think that this way of working together could be normative and even reflexive if it's modeled through leadership behavior. But I do think it probably needs some formal processes around it to create the disciplines in the first instance. Third, if we use these processes, then we can turn to the natural segmenting of the trade policy process and use it to our advantage. So what I mean by that is we often engage in this pre-negotiation process, right, where we sit down with other countries. It's sort of a low-stakes environment. It's not a formal negotiating environment. We're asking each other questions about what the provisions mean. We're sharing information about laws and regulations. We're finding out a whole lot about how the systems in both countries work. That's an incredibly useful time to start identifying the gaps where trade capacity building can be deployed. And if we have a standing committee and we have folks who are dedicated to thinking and hearing in that way, then they should be participating in that pre-negotiation process. That's good prep work. During the negotiation, if we have a new committee like this, then we can discuss across agencies and with the embassies, what are the potential obstacles to even finishing the negotiations? What are the obstacles potentially to implementing the agreement, and begin thinking about that as we're negotiating? And I think critically, if we do that, we have the embassies then providing us with the insights about what's happening on the ground, what's happening in country, and working with the host governments to develop these plans, to co-develop the plans, right? Because it doesn't work if the host government is not involved in developing trade capacity building and in implementing it, because, you know, beyond the U.S. involvement in it, those programs need to be sustainable and continue after formal U.S. trade capacity building assistance. And I do think that we need to start that process, have those discussions as the negotiations are ongoing. The last comment I would make is that I personally don't think we should wait until we're done negotiating to implement trade capacity building assistance. I don't think we should use it as a bargaining chip. I don't think that we should use it as any kind of incentive or leverage in the negotiations. You know, look, the agreements are only as good as can be implemented. So that's an investment that we're making that's important to start up front and not really use it as a bargaining chip in the negotiations. The negotiations are dynamic. They're going to reveal a lot of issues where trade capacity building can be enormously helpful. I think it can help get the negotiations across the finish line. And frankly, you know, our companies want to be able to utilize the agreement on day one. They have to wait for the negotiations to be completed. They wait for Congress to approve it. They wait for customs to implement it. You know, there's a lot of intervening time here where we could be implementing trade capacity building so that on day one, it's useful for our companies and it's useful for companies in the developing country partners. So I think I'll leave it there. Maybe in the Q&A we can come back to the sort of war stories of NAFTA.
Thank you, Andy. Thank you. Paul.
Sure. Well, thank you, Scott and Dan and CSIS again for convening the group and putting the paper together and certainly the leadership of Congressman Boustany and Polis. Maybe I'll just touch on a couple areas. One, as Scott mentioned, I've looked at these issues from different perspectives. Trade and development is a topic that's been around for decades, and it is a logical synergy between the two communities, but I think Dan alluded to, and certainly the Congressman Boustany did, the communities haven't really worked together seamlessly. The trade community from the agency perspective, and Andrea just went through some of the challenges we faced. We have a very disciplined, centralized trade policy making apparatus. The private sector knows how to engage with that apparatus. And yet we have sort of disparate development agencies and the coordination or lack thereof, I think, is held back some of the trade and development opportunity. On the Hill, you see the same phenomenon where I worked on the Finance Committee, you have the Ways and Means Committee who are focused on oversight and trade negotiations. Then you have the Foreign Affairs and Foreign Relations Committees looking at USAID and state, or the Ag Committees looking at USAID. And then we have the appropriators who are funding. And I think the line item is actually very interesting. An important recommendation, because I think our goal has to be, and I think a lot of our discussion in the task force is, how do we make trade and development, how do you make that nexus real? And it's going to take legislative coordination, it's going to take executive branch coordination, and I think what I'd like to focus a few more minutes on is sort of stakeholder coordination, and you touched on this some, is that it's fascinating, even within companies, and when I worked at FedEx and had the opportunity to travel around the world and work with our operators in all these countries of different levels of development, you realize that there's an incredible amount of innovation and creativity and operational know-how. Procter & Gamble, another company where Scott worked, there's this untapped resource, and it's only growing. That one of the biggest changes, a statistic that I think is fascinating, is you look at 1962, when USAID was created, you look at the capital flows into the developing world, and 80% of the capital flows were official development assistance from the developed world. Today, that number is about 10%. It's all private capital flow, it's all remittances. So the landscape of what is actually impacting how developing countries grow is completely different, and it's much more driven by accessing the global economy, by participating in global value chains, by taking on the reforms beyond tariffs, you know, behind the border type issues. So, and who has the best sort of window into which of those problems are the most significant? It's the operators, it's the companies in country. Now, it can be large multinationals that run express delivery networks, but it's also the small businesses in country, in the developing world, or in the United States, trying to figure out how do they partner, how do they access. So, interesting enough, also in many companies, much like the executive branch or the legislative branch, the folks that work on trade policy and work on regulatory barriers are often very different than the folks that work on the foundation or the folks that do the development partnership. So you see that bifurcation within the companies. I think some of the work I've been doing recently or seeing is you're seeing even within companies, they're starting to rethink their own approach in the developing world. So the other trend I think that's very important as we think about the recommendations and how we move forward, there is now a much larger pool of countries that are commercially significant, that are emerging, that are growing. You have companies that are investing, you know, there once was a BRIC strategy, you know, now there's a 50 country strategy. So that means that the companies themselves are investing resources and personnel and their own sort of strategic thinking into different parts of the world in a way they didn't 20 or 30 years ago. In the development community world, many of the large foundations, the NGO actors, the folks who've been delivering global health, food security, clean water, have been in many of those countries for a long time as well. So they have a mission and operational expertise. So it's fascinating to look in country, you see the private sector and the development community working together to solve mm-hmm. complex problems. So we need to take that model and bring it to the executive branch, bring it to the legislative process. I think what I found most interesting in our discussions was the current state of affairs of trade capacity building is there isn't a definition. You know, there's one. There are some definitions, but they're 4 or 5 pages long. So it can be anything and everything. That's probably not going to optimize results.
Right.
If anything we do in the development context could be called trade capacity building, it's unlikely that the way we focus those resources or the way we focus our strategy is going to get the maximized results. The other is prioritization. When you're at each country in this respect, and I completely agree with Andrea that the country planning is so important, is going to be different. If you're a landlocked sub-Saharan African country, the challenges you face in terms of getting to scale or accessing the global economy is very different than if you have a strong port infrastructure on in a region of the world that's located near demand. So mm-hmm. how you would target your trade capacity assistance to those two countries might be very different. The one comment that throughout this process, I was happy to see incorporated in the report, we have to figure out how to integrate that operational expertise, both from the development actors in country and the private sector into this process to help define and to help set the priorities. So I think that's where there's a real opportunity. You know, one of the projects that many are working on right now is implementation of the WTO trade facilitation agreement. There's an example of an agreement that on its face is a trade agreement, which is the first section in terms of a series of commitments that the WTO members have made. But the second section explicitly contemplates donor coordination and contributions to help developing countries meet those standards. So there's a lot of effort going into how do you integrate the private sector expertise into that process? How do you ensure that those resources, that assistance, whether it's bilateral assistance from the United States or multilateral assistance is actually targeting the best practices and tailored to those specific countries. So I think that's a helpful, I think that that's the fact that this is occurring and we're going through the process of hopefully ratification and then sooner rather than later implementation. And as that thinking has been developing, this is very timely because we need to be doing it specifically to implementing that agreement. We also need to be thinking about trade capacity building writ large. Same concept, how do we prioritize? How do we define it? How do we integrate the operators who may not be familiar with the interagency, may not understand exactly how the appropriators work and what foreign relations mm-hmm. does and how finance plays into it. But I can assure you, I had these discussions with my old colleagues. In 5 minutes, they can tell you what's the problem.
Right.
You know, what is it in customs? What is it in business licensing? What is it that's preventing them from participating or competing in that economy? And if we can incorporate that into this process, I think you know the output and the outcome will be much more positive.
Great. Thank you. Thanks to all the panelists. I'd like to now turn to your questions. And just three things to consider before we start. First, when I recognize you, please first wait for the microphone. Okay. Second, when you have we have an online audience that is the main reason, but it's also a big room. Second, please start by letting us know who you are and which organization you represent. And third, I call the Alex Trebek rule, please make sure your question is in the form of a question. With that as a predicate, I'd be delighted to answer questions. Yes, sir. Microphone's on its way.
Back to the Hi, my name is Daniel Gage. I'm with the State Department. Sir, Mr. Delaney, just in reference to your recent comments and to all the panelists, could you give me, I guess, your understanding of the difference between trade facilitation and trade capacity building?
Sure. I don't think it's so much that there's a difference. I think trade facilitation is looking at the sort of core customs administration issues. So it literally is the mechanics of how to get goods in and out of a country. So I think of it as almost a continuum. So
transaction costs.
Yeah. So trade capacity building, you know, it's all about your nexus to trade or your nexus to trade and investment that you can more broadly. So trade facilitation, I think, is sort of, if trade capacity building is anything, it is that. Then you can sort of step back and say there are other issues for implementing different aspects of chapters. It could be regulatory, it could be transparency, it could be even how to negotiate these commitments. So I would say, you know, trade facilitation is clearly a piece of trade capacity building, but I think part of why we need discipline from a interagency process, from a sort of strategy setting approach, is amongst all these other activities that you could notionally consider trade capacity building. I mean, everything you could get as remote to things such as, you know, technology development or education or these types of things, I think is important to consider with limited resources for funding that is intended to generate the capacity to trade. How close is it to that nexus? And the further you get away, there needs to be a strategy or there needs to be an assessment or a metric that's saying, look, these projects, though, you know, well-meaning or certainly maybe should fall under some other aspect of the foreign assistance approach, aren't really about trade capacity building, or they're further away, and perhaps for this country, if we're calling it trade capacity, we should focus on something else. So.
Yeah, I agree with Paul, and Thelma has a point of view as well. For me, think of it as trade facilitation is basically border administration. And the ease and simplicity and clarity and transparency of border administration. But there are a lot of things that happen at the border because it's convenient for them to happen. And those are the elements where trade capacity building makes a difference. If you're an agricultural exporter, okay, there are a whole set of compliance requirements, USDA Foreign Ag Service compliance requirements, which your products must meet to gain entry into the United States. Now, that's not specifically border administration, but it's a task that, for purposes of convenience, occurs at the border. Now, getting farmers to the point where they can comply consistently and seamlessly with those USDA requirements is where trade capacity building makes a difference. It's how you essentially inculcate and develop the standards and move farm exporters to say to risk-based management systems and to really deeply understand and internalize in their own farm processes what it takes to comply with our standards. Okay, so they're really, in some ways, need to be separate animals, I think is the best way to think about it. But Thelma, you had a point.
We have, up until now, talked about primarily how we define these issues. And mm-hmm. that's really important, of course, because it can be so broadly defined that it's hard to measure whether or not you're successful at what you're doing. So from our own point of view, we need to be a bit disciplined about how we calculate this. But I do think we need to recognize that what's really important in this exercise in the context of any trade agreement, and this was certainly true of CAFTA, is that you have to allow the countries to establish their priorities for trade capacity building. And our response to that list both brings them into the process because they've had to develop their priorities. And I think we found in CAFTA that they certainly have, in almost all instances, the ability to define what they would like to see changed in their own economies to help improve their trade agreements. They often don't quite know how to execute, and they want to look to U.S. business particularly and how to do best as to execute. But I do think it's extremely important on the trade capacity building, particularly in the context of a negotiation, to early in the process, as you say, have them start developing their priority lists. so they have a stake in the yeah. outcome.
Agreed. Yes, sir, you had a question? So up here in front, then we'll go a little further back.
Thank you. I'm Jim Suits. I work for the very small trade capacity building unit in the U.S. Department of Agriculture. I noticed one of the central recommendations of the report was the creation of an interagency task force. And my experience has been that those task forces tend to be impotent at best. So I wanted to ask, you mentioned also the provision of funds authority to that task force. My question is, has that been done before to your knowledge, and has it worked?
The one instances of sort of appropriated funding occurred in 2003, 2004, where there was specific, and it was action taken by, at that time, Congressman Colby, House member who was an appropriator, and Senator from New Mexico, Bingaman? Does that ring a bell? In any case, there was a House-Senate agreement on appropriated funds allocated for trade capacity building and operating the bureaucracy better. What I think happened is we didn't continue that. So there was an episodic experience with it, in my recollection. What we haven't done is done it consistently. And I'm empathetic to your comments on interagency groups. It's like the solution, the generic solution to every problem in Washington is create an interagency group. But at the same time, the policy coordination issues are fairly important in getting this effort on trade capacity building to be effective. And we didn't know any other way to bridge the gap between this, as Andrea put it, and as the report puts it, a very centralized capitals-based trade policy mechanism and very decentralized, you know, localities-based aid organization. So it's the best we could come up with. So,
if I could just add to that, in my own personal view is that it's not so important what the structure is, whether it's a formalized task force or I think that, particularly in CAFTA, that experience was whether or not you had strong interagency commitment to this at the highest levels. And the thing that you ran into the most difficulty on was flexibility in the budgets. Trying to persuade, as Scott said, to have that policy commitment to respond to it in the context of a trade agreement to trade capacity building. And then once the agreement is in place, whether that commitment can sustain itself within individual agencies, whatever budget a task force would get would never, you know, be the response that would be needed. What you need to have within agencies is the flexibility to manage the budget so that trade capacity building can be responded to. The difficulty we had with AID during the CAFTA trade capacity building was that they had already programmed all their money. You know, and even right. small amounts of money, a million here, a million there, pretty soon, as Senator Dirksen said, you're talking about real money. But you couldn't, trade capacity building often doesn't take a lot of money. It's you know, you're looking at systems, you're not
training changing, programs, those
you're,
kinds of things.
You're yeah. not changing the agriculture, you know, economy in any one country through trade capacity building necessarily. So trying to persuade through leadership at the interagency level that agencies need to retain flexibility in their budgets so they can actually respond to these things. I'm getting about that microphone. That they can respond to these things is very important.
Yeah. Can I very briefly add to that? Persuasion's tough. I mean, you know, that is how we did it during CAFTA. I mean, we know you convened, and Dan Rundy likes to joke that we beat AID up for their lunch money at that time. Maybe we did. My background is I came up through the trade ranks, and I learned the disciplines of how you develop trade policy through the trade promotion subcommittee process. And there is a process for it. You have subcommittees. Decisions get made in a formal way, in an understood way, in a regular way. And I don't see any reason why we can't bring that kind of discipline to the trade capacity building process. I think we probably need it. I'm not saying USTR should run it, but you know, those kinds of mechanisms are existent in the government, and if we apply that kind of discipline and formality to it, I think it would really help.
Okay. So one very quick point, because I think you're one of the ways an interagency process will function if Congress is watching it. And that's sort of, you know, the interagency process in trade functions for many reasons, but one of the reasons is Congress is very engaged with what's going on in the negotiations on very specific issues. So there's that constant kind of supervisory role. I think the private sector, who's very engaged on with Ways and Means and Finance on trade, is beginning to think about how do we engage in the appropriations process, in the foreign assistance process, because as you said, they have real interests in fixing the agriculture standards issues and fixing these customs issues. So I think it's very encouraging that Congressman Boustany and Congressman Polis came together on this. There's action, I know, on the Senate side, also thinking about, you know, how do we approach trade capacity and work with the trade committees and the foreign relations committees. But I think your skepticism or your experience, I think, is accurate, but in the areas where it has functioned, it's because when those groups are held accountable, when strategies are developed and actually reviewed, and it affects appropriations, then you have a good mix where you can end up with a functioning, more sort of disciplined interagency process.
Okay, I think I've seen four hands, so let's try to go in series here. There are two people on this side. There are actually now three, five. We'll do what we can. Let's start back here at the back, right behind you, Caitlin. We'll get you to right next.
Thank you. My name is John Lamb. I'm with Apt Associates. We're a major U.S. government contractor involved in trade all over the world, but especially in Africa. For over 10 years, we've had an involvement with the trade hubs in Africa. Mm-hmm. We're the major contractor right now for the West Africa trade hub, and we're also a contractor earlier, 10 years ago, in the Southern Africa trade hub. So we've had sort of a mix of experience. There are four kind of frontline issues I'd like to raise with the panel and see what your comments are. In the startup of the new round of trade hubs, there's an issue arose of whether the trade hubs could or should be connected again to investment. So some of them have actually changed the name to trade and investment hubs. Ours hasn't yet in West Africa, but it's an issue that's being discussed. So the first question is, do you think that you can do trade capacity building that's divorced from investment promotion and capacity building? Second one is, there are specific activities that we've run into in the case of West Africa where the biggest single hit on trade expansion in products that have not been successful, particularly under AGOA out of Africa, is actually shea, which employs 10 million women as gatherers in many, many countries of West Africa. The biggest single hit in that industry would be to have the FDA change its interpretation of whether a shea derivative could be used as a cocoa butter equivalent, which is what, in fact, is the case in Europe. So the biggest single action that could be taken to help shea and by extension ag-based exports out of West Africa would be a change in FDA interpretation of regulations in the United States. So do you see involvement by US agencies whose present interpretations or where our own regulations actually impede trade building as part of trade capacity building? Okay, those are two. There's others, but anyway, those are examples.
Thank you. Right behind you, there was a question for a while. Thank you, though. We'll get to that.
Good morning, I'm Barbara Simmons with Tubman University in Liberia, and I'd like to hear from the panel in regard to the reauthorization of the African Growth Opportunity Act, and what you see as the chances of the reauthorization, as well as what is the future of trade with Africa, with or without AGOA?
Okay, thank you. Let's take one question on this side, then I'll come back. So, yes, sir.
Good morning, my name is Luke Nye. I'm with USAID, the Office of Trade and Regulatory Reform. I noticed that each of the panelists have a background in public sector as well as private sector currently, and so I'm curious, you know, you guys mentioned the need for partnerships in terms of trade capacity building. The US government can't do it alone. We can't do it with other public donors, even the multilateral donors. So we need to partner with the private sector. I'm just curious to get your thoughts about what's the best pitch? How should the US government or other donors writ large approach the private sector? Because they do have a vested interest, as you mentioned, in trade capacity building. And I'm thinking specifically of the Trade Facilitation Agreement, where there's obviously a very, very big benefit for the implementation of that agreement. But still you have to get people to pony up money. And so how do you get them to see that it's worth their money to participate in this? Okay. Thank you.
Great. We'll stop there, and we'll hope to get back to some of the rest of you. But anybody want to take a shot? We have trade and investment hubs in Africa, regulatory cooperation issues, AGOA, and the partnerships.
So. Can I do the Shay? I'll do the Shay
sure.
question. Yeah. I like that question. I don't know a lot about the Shay butter specifically, but I think what your question really speaks to is the development community bringing to the trade community a set of obstacles, problems, concerns, issues, opportunities for the women working in that industry that can be solved through trade solutions, right? And it doesn't necessarily require, maybe, fixes through AGOA, I don't know. Maybe there are things that we can do on the regulatory side to pave the way and marry that up with improvements to AGOA. But I think the larger point is we do need to be hearing, the trade community needs to hear things like that, because we're really good at coming up with how you brainstorm the solutions to those things, right? We get really drive into the technical and say, oh, well, okay, maybe it's Europe has already approved it. Maybe there's a way we can expedite our own approval process based on recognizing the way that Europe approved it. I mean, you know, we're really good at kind of brainstorming those things, but I'm not sure we would have thought of looking at the question of shea butter imports were the development community not to have raised that. And I do think AGOA renewal is a good time, an opportune time coming up to do exactly as you suggest. I can't speak to timing for AGOA. I'm more of an executive type branch type person, so I couldn't tell you about those processes. But
Paul, you probably follow AGOA yeah. sure. most closely.
Well, I think so. The AGOA question. I think AGOA. We're in the midst of a very active trade legislative period, and I think AGOA is unique in the sense of its strong bipartisan yes. support and bicameral support. I think how and when AGOA renewal happens. It will be caught up in this larger trade legislative process. So I think though it's somewhat unique, it's part of that process. And so that it's too early to predict exactly. You know, we've heard from Congressman Boustany, you know, a TPA bill could be coming soon. That's sort of the first step, and then how it proceeds from there. I think there are open questions as to duration. You know, how long is it going to be? There's certainly my understanding, you know, the staffs in the House and the Senate have been looking at improvements in a variety of ways to the program. Having been at USTR and worked on AGOA and been at finance and done the oversight of it, I think there's some questions about how do you really maximize utilization of AGOA. It's an interesting, I think it's fascinating that the private sector would like to see increased utilization. The countries would like to see increased utilization. The U.S. government would like to see increased utilization. So you have a shared goal there. Now, what are the constraints? A lot of them are probably capacity yeah. constraints and supply side constraints. So how do you work, whether it's through regional communities, bilaterally, how do you work with the countries to sort of assess where do those supply chain bottlenecks are and how do we address them? And then I think that the question is out there still of with some of the economies that are stronger, or growing more quickly, or larger. From its inception in 2000, the GOA's concept was to transition to permanent bilateral and investment relationships between the United States and Sub-Saharan Africa. So I think that goal still holds. We haven't made that much progress yet. So I think that is part of this discussion is how can we help get further along to that shared goal. So I hope that helps. I realize it's not, I couldn't tell you in 3 weeks it's gonna happen or 4 months, but I think it's great asset is that it has very strong bipartisan support.
If I could, let me connect the notion of AGOA renewal to the question about trade hubs or trade and investment hubs. As Paul pointed out, AGOA is nearly old enough to get a driver's license, okay? It turns 16 next year, all right? So if you think about what's changed in Africa since 2000, the biggest change is the consumer market in Africa itself and the opportunity for products made in Africa for sale in Africa, okay? And this is the part of the economy that desperately needs to be built. It's a much smaller part of the total economy. That internal consumer market is smaller in Africa, given its population, than any other region in the world. And most of that is because the lack of connections, intra-Africa connections. And so to the extent that the trade and investment hubs can address that problem, for me, that's the biggest growth opportunity. There, we'll talk about AGOA, because AGOA is a trade preference program, in terms of exports to the United States. But the core market is for African economies to engage each other on consumer products, essentially, made in Africa for Africa. And that for me, is the puzzle that I'd like to see solved. And if it means going to trade and investment hubs, I think that's great. If anybody else, yes?
I do. Scott, I completely agree with you. It's a point I wanted to make. And I agree that I think the way the U.S. should be engaging Africa now is with that in mind. Because if you look at agriculture alone, AGOA is not going to do it. By 2030, the food market in Africa is projected to be a $1 trillion market.
Right.
Right? So what can we do from the U.S. perspective to engage Africa to improve regional economic integration so that it is a large market for U.S. companies and for African companies?
And Paul, did you have a comment on the partnership?
Yeah, there was the question on how to engage the private sector, and I think the idea, if you develop sort of a strategic level interagency process, definition, priority setting, a strategy, you definitely need to work with the private sector at that level, to sort of look at, as you're looking along the continuum of projects, programs, resources that are available for trade capacity, getting their insight from their operations regionally, multinationally, in various different countries at the strategic level is going to be critical. Because what I learned, and Scott, you were at P&G much longer than I was at FedEx, but each of these companies, they have 3-year, 5-year, 10-year plans. They're projecting growth, demand, shifting consumer trends, market development. They're very sophisticated. And if you can get cross-sectoral input, they have a pretty good sense of where they think things are going. And you need to incorporate that in your sort of strategy level of trade capacity building, because that's how you maximize your benefits. And as you just mentioned, in Africa, the focus has to be on developing, inter-regional investment and supply chains. And you'll hear that at a strategic level from a corporate perspective. But I do think it's equally, if not more important, at the country level, to bring in not just large companies, but the local companies, the subsidiaries or the agents of larger U.S. companies, because they have incredibly diverse contracting relationships. Those are the folks that really, in country, as I said, it could tell you very quickly, here's the problem.
Right.
We can't get out of the port because of this, or our ag ministry has no capacity. So I think it's from both levels, and I think how do you measure success is, as you're developing strategy, you document. If I were on the Hill again, that's what I'd want to know. I'd want to know, who did you talk to, and what did they recommend, and what did you do? And similarly at the country level, I think documenting, here's what the private sector's recommendations were. And then you measure against it.
What are the recommendations in the report? We noted that the fact we have these wonderful industry trade advisory groups, there's this advisory committee structure, and it's all based in Washington. And what we envisioned is each ambassador has his or her own ITAC, in his or her own trade advisory committee, where they're talking to people who are actually engaged in commerce in the market, who frankly know a lot that never gets, never makes its way back to Washington, and because it probably doesn't need to, but it would be really relevant in the country to making a difference in trade performance. So,
well, just to echo that, in the roles that we sat in, and we understood the policy priorities for our companies, but at a country level, we didn't know. We had to go work it ourselves through the country manager. So recognizing that structure exists within the private sector, and then looking at it at the strategic and the country level, and I think it really is important to document what they're saying. Obviously, the private sector is not the only voice. There's other stakeholders, development community, other operators, that certainly should weigh in on that priority, that prioritization. But my sense from my time in the private sector is that there's a very deep understanding of the trade policy process and how you engage. There is a frustration, much of which the CSIS and others have looked at in the past. There's a frustration from the private sector of an inability to access in a consistent or a strategic way U.S. foreign assistance capabilities. where there is a vested interest. Mm-hmm. So I think this will take time. It's not you just turn it on and it'll all work. But I think thinking of it, those two levels probably would be the most effective.
Great. Additional comment to that. I think we need to be careful not to limit ourselves to formal partnerships.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are very few companies that are willing to go through the pain and length of the process to get to the end where you have an MOU with a large agency. Right. It doesn't move fast enough, it's not worth it. However, I'll go back to this example I gave of APEC, where USDA created opportunities. They created it. They used the government-to-government relationship through APEC to create a forum where companies could come in and provide their insights, provide some training in a very technical area like food safety. And I guarantee you, when you create opportunities like that, you have a line out the door of companies who are willing to offer up people with that expertise to provide that kind of capacity building. Because it helps their business, not in a very specific way, in a general way, but it really helps create an environment of compliance and elevated institutional capacity in the markets in which they're trying to operate. But that wasn't a formal, lengthy process to create that opportunity. So I think if we can be creative and do much more of that, you'd have a lot more companies willing to engage.
Just that one other thought is, it has to generate results. If the private sector engages at the strategic or the country level and provides some input and some resources and nothing happens, or it goes off in a different direction, they won't keep coming back. What you need is to start build that positive feedback loop, which probably starts informally.
Right.
But as they see that, that they're actually incorporating some of our observations or our experience, that they then become vested in the success of those of that process. And then hopefully, as I mentioned on the Hillside, eventually that they're actually talking congressionally when they're meeting with their delegation, saying USAID is doing a great program, or USDA is doing this program, or Customs is helping. That starts to build a positive feedback loop on that side too. So this is gonna take time, but the shared interests are there. Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of how do you operationalize it.
And the private sector can really be the delivery system for trade capacity building. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is what the companies want. I mean, that's what the countries want as they identify their priorities more often than not. You alluded to that as they were taking advantage of some of those things in Asia. It's basically if you're creating a response to a regional need in Africa to create a better aviation system, for example. USTDA did this as well. I mean, it was the U.S. expertise that was delivering that trade facilitation, trade capacity building effort to these countries at their request.
And it gets to measuring success. That if the private sector sees the results, and particularly on things like trade facilitation, I mean, you can measure it. Like, how long are the holds? How much stuff is being held? I mean, you can figure out what that is.
Right.
And then you would put in place a program and you say, implement the TFA. Where did it get better?
Right.
And if it
yeah,
did.
And the companies can tell you what
it
got
will. And if they can tell. So you need them also in your monitoring side to say, okay, we put this in place. We've done this technical capacity building. We've built this technology solution. How's it working? How are we, do we need to tinker it? Do we need to improve it? So it is building the relationship, but then it has to be sustained. Because their operations are sustained.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They're still dealing with it.
And companies themselves have identified their own. I mean, most companies have an in-country, they're helping the country do better. Good
own,
corporate
their
citizen.
Their own strategy, their own engagement.
And they really have long ago moved from, let's put our name on a school, let's build a school. They're looking more at sustainable trade capacity type of places they put their own money. And actually, the government is following that model in this kind of discussion.
Okay, we're running out of time, but I do want to have one more question. The gentleman in the back here has been very patient. We'll take this as a final question. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm Won-Ho Kim, a visiting scholar at Johns Hopkins CSIS. For the past several years, I have been involved in Korea's export promotion capacity building assistance towards several Latin American countries. I know this morning we are talking about bilateral trade capacity building assistance from U.S. toward developing countries. But as far as we know, international cooperation has not only bilateral format, but also trilateral format involving a third country, third party, as another donor, right? Mm-hmm. So I'd like to know, okay, my question goes to any panelist. My question is, what you think about the trilateral collaboration possibility, or if you have ever undertaken initiatives in this sense, and what you think about the evaluation? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I think we're about to, particularly with the implementation of the trade facilitation agreement. And I was struck as I reread the report, again, by this need to have the infrastructure within the U.S. government, in large part maybe, to manage our own process of delivering U.S. trade capacity building assistance, but also to work with donors from other governments, the other primary governments, and also the multilateral agencies. There really is an acute need to strengthen that dialogue so that we're being really synergistic about the way we deliver trade capacity building assistance. And I'm not sure that today within the U.S. government there is a clear, simple way of addressing that, of doing that.
I think that's right. Look, we run consistent budget deficits, so it's not like we have a lot of money to throw away at this kind of stuff, and we could use the help. Okay. But the second point I make is we're about to learn about this in the Trans-Pacific Partnerships, where we have a couple of TPP partner economies, right. Vietnam and Malaysia as example, which would be sort of ideal recipients of trade capacity building assistance. And we have other economies who are partners, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, who are long part of the official aid budget countries and have long been involved in foreign assistance of various sorts. And so there's a really creative opportunity. Paul, did you have a
comment? Yeah, the only thing I would add is that I think you're absolutely right that the trade facilitation agreement is going to be a sort of a test run on this, and I'm sure there'll be bumps along the road in terms of each of these entities have sort of different rules or procedures by which they do their donor activity. I think the overarching trend that I mentioned in the beginning, that overall development assistance as a share of the economies in these countries is less and less. So the importance of the various donors coordinating to maximize impact, I think that premium just becomes more important. I think that part of one of the other corollary benefits of better streamlining or coordinating the U.S. development assistance and trade capacity assistance process is hopefully, in working with the private sector, as those best practices are learned, those should be shared lessons, and then you can look at trilateral, multilateral, plurilateral. You see this a lot in finance already, in development mm-hmm. finance. You'll see multiple actors come together in terms of take on different roles in terms of how to finance a project. But I think when it's tackling customs modernization or it's tackling agriculture standards or whatever it may be, there are learnings to be done and then shared, and then hopefully having a more disciplined and senior level engagement, both congressional and executive, they can keep pressure on multilateral institutions and positive pressure, but to focus on prioritization, on results.
If I could just perhaps complicate your question a little bit, because we haven't talked about China at all. I do think that the donor community has changed quite a bit, and some of the ways that it has changed is influence, an effort at influencing. It becomes all the more important, I think, for the U.S. to partner with like-minded countries and provide trade capacity building in a sense that promotes open and open trade and highly interactive trade. Because certainly, some large donors, China being one, but Brazil and others. Have designs, I think, beyond just improving the trade environment. They're looking at increasing their influence over certain countries in a political sense and in an economic sense, which was not all bad. But it is something that the U.S. needs to keep its eye on the ball on, so to speak, and try to make sure. We talked about this a lot at the OECD, it's a good thing that the donor community has expanded beyond the U.S. and traditional Europe and traditional donors. But we do have to be cognizant that not all of those donors really want an open market. And so that's where our multilateral mind needs to continue to be at the forefront.
Well, thank you. And thanks all of you for attending today. We appreciate your interest in the topic. And please join me in thanking our panelists.